Mahavir says that all the substances which are addictive, we should not consume in more than minimum quantity. Now he leaves a little window open for us only because sometimes you have to use it as a medicine. But the diet, what we eat, is very important. Addictive diets, and then he mentions the milk and the butter and the sugar and the honey and the meat and the alcohol. All these are very addictive substances. Once you take it, your mind wants them more. And when the mind wants it more, your mind cannot come to rest. Samadhi becomes impossible, becomes like a distant dream. The problem is he just does not limit himself just to the diet alone. There is alcohol everywhere. And I'm not saying just the alcohol that we mean by alcohol. Any addictive situations outside, we have internet, we have iPhones, iPads, friends, all these substances, all the companies that we're looking for, people try to impress each other. All these are addictive substances. And this draws us to the samsara. This makes us believe in the samsara more. And every time you believe in samsara, you're not believing in God. So your race can be this way or that way, not both. You cannot have it both ways, because if you do, then you're going to be missing out your chance to realize the self. The self is within us, and that's where the matter and the spirit interact. That's where they are. Outside is all material. The problem is, once we get attracted to the outside world, whether it is the group's philosophy, is the people make you believe in certain things, people dress up in certain way, so you get attracted. All these factors draw us towards the samsara. So there is, in that sense, we really immersed, completely immersed in alcohol all the time. And that's addictive. You want friendship, but then you cannot decide which way the friends are gonna go. You want to be acceptable by the group of friends that you really want to be in. But then with the group comes the rules. If they are doing certain things, unless you do that, you cannot be part of the group.
Correct.
So those are the rules, and in that case, you may not even feel like doing it, but you do it anyway, just so that you can fit in the group. And then the habit happens, the repeated groups keep on meeting, and then whatever the group's destiny takes it, group has no soul, like we talked. Groups are by the ideologies. Look at the Sunnis and Shiites fighting, all because of their belief in the system, their doctrines that they have decided. The only difference between Shiites and Sunnis is the Sunnis believe in Muhammad, Prophet Muhammad himself and his descendants. And Sunnis says, no, there should be an appointed prophet, the follower, the minister who will lead the group. That's the only difference. They both are Muslims, they are brothers, but the eventual fights that's going on in the Iraq is amazing. And this hatred, the greed, and all these things have been going on for thousands of years. I was reading an article in the last Time issue, The End of Iraq. Beautiful article. At the end, the author made a very, very nice remark. He says, Bush tried to give them democracy. Bush tried to bring them up to the mind level, to the same standard that we are having, and eventually going toward the prosperity and peace. But Shiites and Sunnis fight has been going on for thousands of years, and the same tries have been done by Alexander the Great, Ottoman Empire. All the lot of people have invaded and intervened, but the ultimate survivor is something that is beyond all of us. The fight between the Shiites and Sunnis has been going on. The hatred, the greed, the tribalism, that this is my tribe and this is your tribe, is thousands and thousands of years old. And people can intervene, they will not be able to solve it. So our oldest enemy is within us. The moment you say that I want to belong to this group, you are sacrificing yourself from within. We don't have time to study our own self. So whenever we decide to be called Hindu, we're giving up, we're accepting their rules and regulations that you have to put a tilak, you have to do this, you have to have janois, you have to all these things. Whether we like it or not, you have to do it to be part of it. We don't even care whether we are really Hindu at heart or not. It doesn't matter. External characteristics force us to do that. Same thing with Jainism, same thing with Muslim. All religions are nothing but factories to make the iron change. They're binding you. Even though it doesn't even make sense, you keep on doing it routinely. And these are the things that Mahavir says are should be avoided. You have to go within to find out your real self. Then only your outside behavior will be meaningful. The problem is, why do we want to go outside and belong to other people? Because the problem is, we do not know ourselves. And when we do not know ourselves, ourself is the part of pleasure, is the happiness, the bliss. The bliss is another name of Paramatma. There is total happiness within us, Sat, Chit, and Anand. Sat is the ability to create, Chit is the awareness, and Anand is the ultimate peace and bliss. That is within us. But since we cannot go in because of our vrittis and vasanas, and which makes us keep running towards the samsara, we try to think that we're going to get the same bliss outside. So outside people becomes the possible source of pleasure for us. Wife wants the pleasure from husband. Husband wants the pleasure from wife. But they both are lost. Nobody knows their own self. Everybody is acting at the superficial level. Everybody is coming with their agenda. I want peace from my wife, but my wife also wants peace from me, and I am not at peace. What am I going to do? I can't give her what she wants, and she can't give me what I want either. So the solution is to find yourself first, have peace within your own heart, start giving peace, and hopefully you will receive peace too. But giving peace, hopefully, is the key word. Well, again, you know, we hope that we all are traveling on the same path. But that's where this illusion comes in. So the Maya is so powerful that our belief that we're going to get pleasure from outside is the power of Maya. It's an illusion that we are carrying along with us. And we are running outside because of our vrittis and vasanas. So Mahavir says that when you consume these products, it stimulates the lust within you, and you keep running again and again and again after these objects of pleasure, whether it are the objects or the people or the situation which are created outside, that we get addicted to it. And then our run starts outside. So our vrittis and vasanas are responsible for this. And the more we run, the more vasanas and vrittis are being condensed. It more intensified within us, and we become vrittis and vasanas. We get defined by our vrittis and vasanas. So we almost accept our real self, we don't know. So we pick up whatever is outside. See, if I am a drunkard, I accept it that I am a drunkard. Not realizing that you are not the body, you are not the mind, you are the soul. Soul doesn't need alcohol. But your body does. Body is addicted. Mind is addicted. But we identify ourselves with the mind and the body and start behaving that I am a drunkard. This is what I like. And we cannot think of anything else. As long as we keep on consuming alcohol and keep on getting addicted, there is always a pleasure available for the next time until we go down and we suffer. We miss the chance of learning, realizing the self. So we put almost like fake facades in front of our face, artificial masks in front of us, and then we're walking around. Everybody is walking around with a mask on their face. And as soon as the mask goes on, we behave like that. We picked up the mask of Hinduism. If a child is born and is transferred to the Muslim family overnight, he's going to be picking up the mask of a Muslim or a mask of a Hinduism or a Buddhism. Whatever. These are the masks which are given to us. When the child is born, he or she doesn't care any mask we give it to him, he will pick up. But these are the masks. There was a famous author named Tolkien. He describes in his life that he, at the age of 8 or 9, because he was born and brought up in a very literate family, and they were heavily into literature. And so he grew up with a lot of people who were interested in dramas and all these things, very literally classics they used to read and all those things. So one day, as he was playing around in the house, he ended up in a room which had all the different masks. They were kept for performing different characters. And in those days, they used to wear the mask to bring out the character, just like our Kathakali dances and angry face and all those things. So he happened to pick up a demon's face. So he picked up, and he was just playing around, and all of a sudden, he started thinking that he's a demon. He has to start acting like a demon. There was a wooden sword around. He picked up and started swaying around, and he got like angry, and he started behaving. And in that process, he ended up breaking some of the masks, which are made out of mud. And they fell, and they made some noise. So people came from the family, and they started laughing. So how in a second he changed himself, and they were laughing. But he said, I was literally scared. He says, everybody was laughing. They thought it was just a cool joke. But that incident stayed in my head rest of my life, that once we pick up the mask, it literally changes us. It makes me forget what I am. So all these masks, we are doing the same thing. We are walking around with different masks. But inside that, our consciousness is hidden, we don't even know about. Because we are so fully occupied we take our roles so seriously. And that's the Sanskrit and the scripture say is the Maya. Maya is the illusion. Illusion that makes us forget what we are, but accept whatever we see. And to the point that we ready to even sacrifice a lot of things which are scientific facts. I always give an example of those two twins which were born in Russia. And they were exchanged. No, not twins. There were two girls born in Russia. And after 16 years, it was found out that those girls were exchanged between the families. Because they were lying side by side. The nurse was there. The nursing supervisor came to making rounds. And the one baby was missing was brought somewhere else just to show that she's doing a good job. She put the other baby in the banister. And then, as soon as they left, before she could undo her mistake, the family came and picked up the baby. Now she was too afraid to go and tell that she has made a mistake. So it went on for 16 years. Mm-hmm. Somehow with the fluke of luck, it was discovered.